Hi everyone, I'm Dr. Marilyn Markel, an assistant professor of economics at Illinois College, a small liberal arts college in Illinois. And I'll be talking to you today about incorporating popular culture into your economics courses. As with most brilliant ideas, I'm of course not the first person to think about teaching with media and popular culture, so I'd like to note that my talk today and the activities I'll be sharing with you are heavily inspired and sometimes utilize the pop culture econ series linked here, and Jadrian Wooten's Econ Media Library website also linked here. Before I discuss today's topics, I'd like to give you a little background and context. I have the course objectives listed here, but essentially a first-year seminar, or FYS, at my institution is part content and part what I like to think of as College 101. We discuss what college is, what the liberal arts are, and what a liberal arts education means. I teach skills like time management, note-taking, how to manage stress, and interpersonal relationships, and a lot more. All of these are formal topics and ideas covered in the course. The other part of the time in the course covers content of the faculty members choosing. As you can see from this wall of text, it's a lot, and it's especially a lot for a first college course these students walk into. So because this could be a really overwhelming class, and I really don't want it to be, for my first year seminar, I wanted to avoid simply repeating an introductory econ course, and I wanted to do a lot less formal modeling to balance all of these objectives. So I decided to create a course about one of my side passions, popular culture and media generally. So I have a little context. What I'll be doing today is walking you through three foundational econ topics, some associated media, and an activity for each of these core concepts. I've provided resources for the topics I'll cover today in a Google Drive, which I have linked at the end of this video. I cover these topics on the screen with these media. Some of these media come from the popular culture textbook series, and some of these are my own. I show short clips, which may or may not be directly from the long form media that week, in the classroom while discussing the economic topic, and students watch longer media on their own, and then we discuss those media in class. For this presentation, I'll be covering three topics: marginal benefits and marginal costs, and decision making, negative externalities, and money. For my first topic today, I'll be discussing marginal benefits and marginal cost analysis. I utilize the media Edge of Tomorrow, and I use three short clips. Edge of Tomorrow is a remake of a Japanese film called All You Need Is Kill, and it centers on a man, Major William Cage, in the middle of an alien war. He isn't really a frontline soldier, but he finds himself there anyway and pretty much immediately dies, covered in sort of alien goo. Miraculously, he wakes up back at the start of his day, which is essentially the beginning of his time loop. If you've seen Groundhog Day, you kinda get this already, but with an alien war. The rest of the movie is essentially Cage dying over and over again as he trains with the sergeant to defeat the aliens. I use this film to discuss marginal benefits and marginal costs, and more generally the way we think about decision-making in economics. Obviously, as we discuss in class, we don't all get to redo our day every day until we get it right, but we do make choices and we do learn from those choices. In class discussion, we break down three major decisions Cage makes in the movie and list and discuss any of the benefits and the costs and the circumstances surrounding his choices. We discuss how Cage must have quantified those items, both benefits and costs, and if Cage made a good economic choice, essentially did its benefits that the class determines outweigh his costs that the class determines. I then have students form small groups to discuss two more decisions. I give the class one decision all groups must discuss, and for the third, the group decides on their own. We stop to discuss after the second and third choices, each time listing benefits and costs and determining if Cage or another character has made a good economic choice. My activity for this topic is pretty simple, as it's pretty early in the semester, and we're really just getting going and adjusting our thinking to think like an economist. So then, in addition to the class discussion, I have a handout for students to review marginal benefits, marginal costs in the real world. This is linked in the Google Drive at the end of the presentation, but essentially what I have students do is walk through marginal benefit, marginal cost for pizza, shoes, and a good of their own group's choosing. Groups are asked to quantify the benefits and costs using their own judgment, Google, local prices, etc., for these three goods, and then discuss the right amount to buy. After students determine if they should buy the first unit of the good, like the first piece of pizza, I ask them to do it again for a second, a third, etc. Before doing so, I remind them of diminishing marginal returns and that the benefits eventually will slow. The second core topic I'd like to talk about today is externalities, and specifically negative externalities, utilizing the media Deepwater Horizon. There's a lot of really good examples here, but I find that Deepwater Horizon really gets to the core of the idea really fast. The short clips I use in class are a negative externality example from the Big Bang Theory and a positive externality example from an Axe commercial. Deepwater Horizon is a dramatized version of the events leading up to and slightly after the explosion in the Gulf, which caused the largest to date oil spill in the world. As you can probably guess, this is a perfect example of negative externalities. In our class discussion of negative externalities, we also discuss some possible fixes. Again, I break students into small groups and ask them all about the possible impacts that the oil spill caused. Often students have a really long list for this. In a full class discussion, I ask students to discuss why their ideas are externalities. For example, if students note that there's a cost imposed on the environment, I ask them how that's an externality, and then we discuss further. I then ask students to think about solving these problems or if a solution is impossible. Usually students put themselves in the role of government pretty immediately for this one and come up with taxes and regulations. We then discuss what might have happened with Deepwater Horizon should their ideas have been implemented. I round out this discussion by leading students through and asking students about other examples of negative externalities of both consumption and production. The activity I utilize for this is a problematic roommate activity. In this activity, students are paired up. One student is the neutral roommate and the other student is the bad roommate. The setup for this activity is that the bad roommate is causing harm to the neutral roommate. Pairs can come up with their own external cost, or you can assign them things like noisy roommate, messy roommate, they stay up too late with the light on, or something like that. Whatever the act actually is, the cost has to be monetary. So the dollar amounts of 20, 50, and 100 are pretty easy to implement and randomly assign across groups. Students are then asked to solve the problem. Should they need guidance, you can give them a range of choices, such as the neutral roommate can pay the bad roommate $10. Would this solve the problem? Why or why not? Etc. Give students some time to work this out. If you have time, you can have a neutral roommate and a good roommate instead and discuss positive externalities. Good roommates may clean the bathroom for the whole suite. After the pairs discuss, I come back together as a full class and review each pair's outcome. Another extension of this activity is to have the hall director, the instructor, you, step in and set fees or rules, taxes and regulation, or gifts like subsidies, should you have time. The last topic I'll cover for you today is money. I utilize the long-form media Mad Max Fury Road, and I utilize some short supplements like A Series of Unfortunate Events and Scrooge McDuck. Mad Max Fury Road is an excellent film for discussing many, many economics topics. Things like scarcity, it's a post-apocalypse, things are scarce, including aquacola or water and blood. Opportunity cost, many major choices with obvious trade-offs happen in this movie. Means of production, war boys are labor and pulleys are capital. And money, there is no money. I set this movie up as part review. We've discussed things like scarcity, opportunity cost, by the end of the semester, and students notice and bring these ideas up, and part new content. The point of Furiosa, one of the main characters driving a truck across a desert, is to trade with Gas Town and Bullet Town. Students see the benefits from trade, no problem. After students watch the movie and we discuss previous materials, I ask why. Why does Furiosa have to take the Citadel's goods all the way to the other towns? What's missing from this world? And students almost immediately realize that it's money. We then talk as a group about any problems with this world not having money and why the world might not have money. And after this discussion, I go straight into the activity. This activity is a long one and typically takes most of the class. I also do this before discussing the functions of money or any desirable properties of money. For this activity, each student is assigned a job or a good or service that they produce. They're also assigned two or more, depending on your class size, goods that they want. Students, completely on their own, have to walk around class or even outside to find someone that they can actually trade with. I typically do about 10 minutes for the first round. Be sure to remind students that if they can't find someone to trade with directly, they can try and make a chain of trading. Some students find success in trading, but it's quite rare for most of the class to successfully trade. After you thoroughly frustrate your students, introduce money. You can allow students to haggle or you can set prices beforehand, putting these up on the board or on a slide. Set the same time limit and let students exchange money for goods and services now instead of bartering. Students should finish their purchases much faster if you have all matching production and consumption, and definitely more efficiently. After this activity, I asked students in a whole class discussion what happened. What took so long in the first round and what changed that made things feel faster in the second round, or actually be faster in the second round, and then connect it back to Mad Max Fury Road again. I then asked pointed questions about how money worked and what money did in the second round, and I transitioned this discussion into the functions and properties of money, bringing up the activity in Mad Max Fury Road throughout. You can add an intermediate round where the money is not convenient or is like really awkward. Large bouncy balls or books or ping pong balls work well here to be kind of weird money. And in the third round, use fake paper money. This intermediate round would depend on time, of course. Thanks for taking the time to listen in today, and I hope that you now have some ideas to bring into your own classrooms. On screen and in the comments are a link and QR code to a short but expanding list of ideas and activities, including any sources I use in my classes. Any questions, don't hesitate to contact me at marilyn.markel@ic.edu, which is on screen as well. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Stefani Milovanska-Farrington. I currently teach economics at the University of Tampa, and today I will introduce you to Choice Economics Materials for Success on Substack. These are worksheets based on recent and interesting news articles appropriate for principles of economic classes. The materials are freely available, and I believe that you, your students, and your children might find them useful. While you're listening, I strongly encourage you to check out Choice Economics Materials for Success on Substack, and if you find the materials useful, I would greatly appreciate it if you could subscribe. I will first start with the reasons why I started to create these worksheets for my students. We often hear as educators that economics is hard, that it is confusing, the students are not interested, they don't want to participate, they're not engaged, and even what you remember, they quickly forget. So I started to look for solutions. What I wanted to create a product which will help students understand the material rather than just memorize the material. I wanted to do this through real-world examples, to help students retain information in the long run, to relate the theory to the real world, to make the material relevant to the students, interesting to the students, because when they are interested, they would also be more engaged. So I wanted to increase student engagement by making the material relevant to the students, by encouraging discussion, collaboration between students and between the students and the teacher. And finally, I also wanted to help students develop some critical thinking and analytical thinking skills that will help them succeed in the future, regardless of whether their major is economics or not. So I started to create worksheets with questions based on recent news articles that are relevant to the students and that provide real-world examples of the material covered in Principles of Economics classes. I called the materials Choice Economics Materials for Success. And just to give you some idea about the articles that I select, I'm very selective when I choose articles. So one of the examples was Why Live Nation and Ticketmaster Dominate the Live Entertainment Industry. So I related this to market structures and more specifically to monopoly. And when I gave this worksheet to my students, that was exactly at the time when they were looking for tickets for Taylor Swift's concert. So they were very excited. They knew about the event. They were seeing those high prices and they were excited. Why is this happening? Another example, why airlines like extra fees so much? Again, something that they are excited about, something interesting, something they see and want to understand why this is happening. Another example, should you give up your salary and go to graduate school? This was an article published in Wall Street Journal earlier this year, and I related that to opportunity cost, something very, very relevant to the students, a very relevant topic. And again, when it's relevant, when they're excited, they're more willing to discuss, more willing to learn. In the worksheets, I usually include different types of questions. Questions that just test students' comprehension of the article, and some basic questions that just to make sure the students understand how this article is related or how it provides an example of the concept or idea that I'm trying to discuss with the students. And of course, there are some more challenging questions to encourage higher level thinking and longer term retention of the material. I completely understand that some articles are long, so they're not appropriate for the classroom. Or even if we assign them as homework, students might still not be interested in reading too much. So in order to solve that problem, I include excerpts from the articles at the beginning of the worksheets. So those excerpts are enough, they're sufficient for the students to be able to answer the questions and to understand the basic idea of the article, what the article is about. I also include a list of the topics that the article relates to at the beginning of the worksheets, and learning objectives that educators, teachers, parents might find useful as well. So why do I think that these worksheets are good for my students and also for your students or your children? I add more and more worksheets on a regular basis. So in this way, you will always have something new, something relevant, examples that are currently happening, and students might even be familiar with them. That would encourage discussion. Help students learn from each other. That increases engagement, and it's also more fun for the students. The articles and the questions that I write are based on the best practices that we know for effective learning from the cognitive psychology and the science of learning, including space practice, interleaving, provision of concrete examples, retrieval practice, dual coding, and elaboration. And we know from previous research that these practices actually encourage higher level thinking. The worksheets and the questions always also allow students to learn by doing, so they are good for experiential education, for experiential learning. I will discuss these strategies for effective learning, or as some people call them, power tools, how I use them when I create those questions, but also if you are creating your own worksheets, which you can do, of course, how you could apply these strategies. So first of all, it is important to include questions from multiple topics in every worksheet that you give to your students. Interleaved, or as we call it also mixed or varied practice, helps students make connections between different topics. And that helps them understand how all the material is related. And also it allows students to review the material another time. It allows for spaced repetition. And both interleaving and spaced repetition are known to increase students' information retention. So even if you see some article and you're not currently teaching the material it relates to, it's okay to give it to the students. That would allow students to interleave and to and it would also allow for spaced repetition. Another thing that is very, very important is to have examples that are recent, relevant, concrete examples. Real world stories bring the theory into the real world. When the examples that you give to your students are relevant to them, they are more interested. When they're more interested, they're more willing to discuss. That increases engagement, participation, and it's not just that students learn from each other. It is just amazing how students can inspire each other to learn. That will also improve their ability to recognize applications of the material in the real world on their own as well. It's always good when you give questions to your students, though, to make sure that they are not actually trying to just review the material, that they are trying to actively generate knowledge from the memory. This is what we call retrieval practice. Another thing that is very important is to make sure the students are reflecting on their learning, that they understand how they got to the answer, what they did right, what they did wrong, and why this happened. Elaboration is also very important, explaining everything in details to make sure the students understand what they did right, what they did wrong, and why. When I create worksheets, I also provide answer keys where I have not only the answers, but also the explanations. That is useful for educators. You can use that information to provide some constructive feedback to the students. A few more things that are probably worth mentioning is that the questions in the worksheets, in my worksheets and also in yours probably, should target different levels of learning. Just some of them should test basic understanding of the material, and some should encourage higher level thinking. Also, it is important to include questions of various structures. I like including graphing questions to allow also for duo coding and analogy questions which allow students to build connections. The analogy questions are known to encourage higher level thinking because they allow students to evaluate or require students to evaluate different examples. How could you use this worksheets, mine or your own? You can assign them as homework practice, but I would personally recommend that you use them for team pair share exercise because that will also encourage students to discuss, to collaborate, and of course learn from each other. I currently create worksheets that are based on recent articles. There are opportunities for future extensions of this project. Maybe workbooks can be created to facilitate the use of these materials in a classroom setting. This is something that I'm currently working on. And also in the future, it's possible to create some graphics to capture that power of dual coding that I, that is some opportunity for future extension as well. So I will finish with a couple of requests to you. Please check out Choice Economics Materials for Success. If you haven't done that already, you can go to the archive and you will see all the materials that I've currently created and posted. They are all free, as I mentioned earlier. Please, please, please share this with your network, with your colleagues, with your friends, with some homeschooling parents, with students who are learning economics. And I would really appreciate your feedback, some feedback about the current materials, some feedback, what can be done better, some ideas for future improvement and extensions. And I would also greatly appreciate if you have some funding ideas, because I'm currently doing this for free as a hobby. But if there are any funding opportunities, that would be wonderful and a great encouragement and great way to continue doing what I'm doing. And hopefully together we'll one day create a world where students will say, economics, wow, I understand this. And maybe, just maybe, this is also fun. If you have any questions, I am happy to answer. And I would like to also hear from you and to thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Natalie Quinn. I'm the course lead and also the economic subject lead for the new foundation year in philosophy, politics and economics at the University of Oxford. In this presentation, I will discuss curriculum design for the PPE foundation year, focusing on the economics element of the course. I will start with some context. The Astrophoria foundation year is a new year zero program at the University of Oxford. Course design is currently underway. The first cohort of students has been recruited and they will start their studies in the autumn. It's a one-year, fully funded foundation programme designed for UK state school students with significant academic potential, whose score attainment is expected to be below potential as a result of severe personal disadvantage or disrupted education. This means that, despite their potential, they are not in a position to make a competitive application for direct entry to our undergraduate degree programmes. The foundation year is accredited at level 4, and students who complete it successfully, attaining an average mark of 40 or more, will be awarded a certificate of higher education. Students who attain a final mark of 60 or more will progress to the first year of the undergraduate programme, should they wish to do so. Four courses will be available in the first year of this new programme: a joint course leading to chemistry, engineering or materials science, a joint course leading to one of several of our humanities degree courses, including classics, English and history, law leading to just law, and PPE, the focus of this presentation, from which students will progress to the undergraduate course in philosophy, politics and economics. I will now explain the goal of the PPE foundation year. The Oxford PPE degree is a three-year programme. Students typically enter directly from A-levels or equivalent qualifications such as IB. There are no compulsory subjects required for entry, although maths is recommended and around 95% of successful applicants do have A-level maths or an equivalent. Students study all three subjects in their first year, taking their preliminary examinations or prelims at the end of that year. Most students focus on two of the three subjects after that, although it is possible to continue with all three. Second and third year courses are all examined in finals at the end of the third year. The subject content covered in the first year is both very broad and a substantial step up in difficulty from A-level. To take an example from economics, we cover consumer and producer theory at intermediate level in the first year course, with calculus fully integrated. Finals courses are more specialised and more challenging again. The step up in the academic skills that students are expected to master alongside the content is more radical than the step up in difficulty of content between A-levels and prelims. Students will be expected to demonstrate substantially more academic maturity, independence of thought, and sophisticated problem-solving skills. The step up in skills between prelims and finals is less significant, although many students do develop stronger skills over the course of their second and third year. And we don't explicitly teach these academic skills, although the Oxford tutorial system does provide good opportunities for individual feedback and skills development. So how do PPE students cope with these demands? The PPE selection criteria emphasise learning, reasoning, and communication skills. As a highly competitive course, we have the luxury of being able to select and admit candidates who have outstanding abilities and already well-developed skills in these areas. While successful candidates for the foundation year are expected to have excellent potential and underlying abilities, we wouldn't expect them to have similarly well-developed academic skills. As an additional year between A-levels or equivalent and the prelims courses, the foundation year provides an opportunity to focus on the academic skills development that will be needed to allow these students to thrive on the undergraduate programme. Achieving this is the primary goal of the PPE Foundation Year. Of course, academic skills cannot be developed in the abstract, so that will be done in the context of appropriate and engaging subject content, on which more shortly. I will now focus briefly on the structure of the PPE Foundation Year. This has been developed in light of experience from a pilot Foundation Year that has been implemented at Lady Margaret Hall, one of the constituent colleges of the university, over the last few years. Unlike other University of Oxford undergraduate courses, the foundation year has a modular structure, with assessment credit allocated to each of seven subject modules. Subject teaching will be delivered through a combination of lectures, classes, and tutorials, reflecting standard Oxford undergraduate PPE teaching patterns and providing the opportunity to develop the skills needed to learn through each mode of teaching. For each of the three core subjects, philosophy, politics, and economics, there will be 2 6-week subject modules. These will focus on subject-specific academic skills development. The subject content has been chosen to complement and prepare for the subject prelims courses, while being engaging and relevant to maintain student interest. For each subject, the first module acts as a bridge from level 3, that is A-level or equivalent, to level 4, while the second module, to which is assigned 70% of the subject assessment weight, is fully taught and assessed at level 4. That is, first year undergraduate level. Maths for PPE is slightly different, as it will run at a lower intensity throughout the academic year. It will make a gentler transition from level 3 to level 4, and will have relatively more contact time than the other subject modules. The reason is the importance of building a solid foundation of maths skills to enable the students to thrive on the undergraduate PPE programme. We also anticipate that some students may need particular support, either because they have not taken A-level maths, or because they have experienced particularly weak teaching of maths at school. The Maths for PPE course is being carefully structured to cover material in a coherent order that also aligns well with the economics modules, ensuring that students are ready to apply mathematical methods when required in economics. It also covers methods that will be useful for undergraduate philosophy and politics courses. The preparation for undergraduate studies course is common to all of the Astrophoria Foundation Year courses, serving as an underpinning element of the Foundation Year. It will include general academic skills classes, individual academic mentoring and academic writing sessions, communication skills classes and tutorials, and lectures and classes on society and culture. For the rest of the presentation, I will focus in more depth on the economics subject elements of the PPE Foundation Year. As mentioned, the goal of the PPE Foundation Year is to develop the academic skills that will allow the Foundation Year students to thrive as undergraduate students of PPE. This goal is reflected in the intended learning outcomes for the economic subject modules. These cover independent learning skills, economic writing skills, problem-solving skills, data interpretation, visualization, and analysis skills, and skills in choosing appropriate concepts, models, and methods to analyze applied questions. In each case, carefully structured learning activities are being designed to support the development of these skills, with greater independence expected as students progress through the modules. To give an example, for writing skills, we start with a focus on precise use of economics terminology, for instance, making a clear distinction between income and wealth. We progressed to writing logical chains of reasoning for economic explanations, then including the use of illustrative examples. By the end of the first module, the students will be asked to structure a whole essay, and they will have plenty of essay writing practice in the second module. The economics assessment criteria, which are still under development, also reflect our focus on subject-specific academic skills. Our assessment framework requires markers to look for qualities of command of material, analysis, exposition, judgment, and independence. We are developing descriptors for how these qualities may be demonstrated in questions that assess the different intended learning outcomes. For example, good exposition for a problem-solving question will require appropriate use of notation and structuring of the answer. Good judgment for an essay question will include appropriate choice of illustrative examples. The key challenges that we are tackling are calibrating the pass mark of 40 at which students will be awarded a Level 4 Certificate of Higher Education and the progression mark at 60 at which students will be judged ready to progress to and thrive on the undergraduate programme. We need engaging and relevant economic subject content through which we can develop the students' academic skills. Ideally, that will not be micro, macro, and quants, as both Year 1 and Year 2 of the undergraduate programme have this structure. We want to avoid too much content overlap with A-level or Year 1, but to cover content that complements and prepares for Year 1. In fact, there are many topics that are touched on very briefly in Year 1, for example, comparative statics and partial equilibrium. So the foundation year gives us an opportunity to explore these in more depth. The textbook Economic Society and Public Policy from Core Econ provides us with an ideal framework. It's designed for economics courses for non-specialist students. As such, its emphasis is very much on context, and theory is developed through applications rather than in the abstract. ESPP also has great coverage of what we might call economics general knowledge or cultural capital, things we expect students to simply know or absorb, but which we would like to cover more explicitly with our foundation year students. We will cover the first three units of ESPP. The first explores big picture questions, while the second and third focus on social interactions and public policy. The ESPP content is ideal, but how does it integrate with our focus on skills development? The units that we'll cover link to a wide variety of sources. We are adding more. Through complementary core econ teaching materials, including doing economics and experiencing economics, there is good coverage of data interpretation and analysis. We are developing some complementary materials to fill a few gaps. ESPP is less well aligned with our needs on writing and problem-solving skills. We are developing more complementary activities and materials to cover these. Thank you for watching. I would be delighted to receive any feedback.
Does anyone recognize this music? If not, then sorry to inform you, but you do not belong in Generation Z and you do not use TikTok.
We do not belong in Generation Z, but we do use TikTok, only for educational purposes, of course. My name is Katerina Raoukka.
And my name is Andri Kyrizi, and together we have won a teaching grant allowing us to reconstruct a first year compulsory course, Principles of Macroeconomics.
At a university which exhibits a strong generational component, we were faced with a challenge. Students with narrow learning experiences and educators who have not updated their material in many years. Before we took over the course, which was in 2020, the teaching methods were one would call traditional and somewhat out of date. Teacher-centric, with the lecturer taking over the learning environment, slides with too much text, strong dependency on a single textbook material, tutorial questions extracted from the textbook.
Not very attractive, is it? Not for a group born in the digital world. What makes this group so different? According to various sources, few of their characteristics relevant to education include them being digital natives, needing instant recognition of achievements, having an entrepreneurial and competitive nature.
We wanted to internalize these characteristics, hence the reason for the decision of a complete course makeover. The first thing we adopted was what we called the flipping video methodology, a partly hybrid teaching methodology using online asynchronous material. This allows us to incorporate the fact that Generation Z prefers communicating through pictures and sounds rather than texts.
In essence, we take content that is
dry,
no,
less interesting,
well,
technical,
yes, and place it in short videos which the students have to watch before each lecture. Let's see an example.
As you can see, the videos are accompanied by music that this generation seems to follow on social platforms such as TikTok. The idea is to create a familiar audiovisual environment to attract them as much as possible.
The aim of this specific video was to show students how the CPI and inflation are constructed using a numerical example. We have created similar videos for GDP, growth rates, the loanable funds market, and other topics.
Taking out this content from lecture time provided space for constructive activities within classroom that connect theory to the real world. Most importantly, though, we allow access to educational material that the student would need for future courses as well, whenever it best suits their individual needs.
One of the characteristics of Gen Z is that they are impatient and want immediate feedback. Of course, we cannot offer that for all of their assessments. For that reason, we created formative assessment accompanying each video. Solutions become available immediately, providing direct feedback.
To assess the effectiveness of all the components of the teaching innovation, we ran a questionnaire from which we collected 249 responses. We also ran focus groups with 36 students sharing their views and ideas. Now, did the students find this part of the innovation helpful? Their satisfaction is high, with 70% of the students providing a rating between 4 and 5. Asking them what elements they liked the most, they said that the videos were a stepping stone towards understanding the lecture, that they would watch it at their own pace and time, and that the exercises were great for practice.
It wasn't only us creating videos during the course, internalizing their creative and competitive nature, we set up an assessment of a digital form. We already know that they are vloggers and enjoy digital publishing. For this assessment, the students are randomly placed into groups of five, and they are allocated a topic which is current, yet not covered by the taught material. Within a time limit of 5 minutes, the students create a video in which they describe and briefly elaborate on the topic through their independent research.
Our goal was to promote teamwork and provide the opportunity for them to use their video making skills in combination with their knowledge accumulated throughout the course. In a nutshell, we wanted to convert an addiction into learning. Moreover, research has shown that this group of students often or always feels lonely. This assessment type brings first-year students together and helps them meet new people.
For this part of the teaching innovation, student satisfaction was very high. Asking them what elements they liked the most, they said that creating the videos helped them acquire a new skill, enhanced their collaboration skills, and aided in connecting theory with the real world.
To enhance their skills related to employability, we created problem sets involving data collection from databases such as World Bank and FRED, and manipulation of data using Excel. This was the first time students were introduced to databases, and you guessed right, we created a video showing them how to do that with music.
Wanting to divert away from the answers in the textbook methodology, we created tutorial questions which are more research-oriented. For example, one of the questions was, from the content of your lecture on monetary system, explain using 300 words what created the Silicon Valley bank crisis. This is a question for which students need to read specific articles from economic newspapers such as The Economist and The Financial Times. We managed to reduce the stroke dependence on the textbook, providing the students an opportunity to seek knowledge beyond the material given to them.
That sounds challenging for first-year students, and indeed it was. According to student feedback, they found the level of difficulty high and they would have liked a little bit more guidance. They told us that they learned a lot of new material but felt pressure in constructing their answers. We heard them and we provided more guidance this current term.
Finally, for many years, the total mark of this module was based on roughly 30% midterm exam and 70% final exam, both of which were MCQ structured. We adopted a system in which the students can submit a number of assessment pieces. One of the greatest changes involved the shift away from the multiple choice question exams to explanatory questions related to real world.
Asking the students which part of the exam reflects their knowledge better, 70% of them responded in favor of the explanatory questions. Now, we are not saying, of course, that MCQs are an ineffective method of assessment, but the students feel that it doesn't fairly reflect their abilities, so we took that into account. This teaching innovation was not only a great experience for the students, but also for us.
Teaching using various sources, engaging the students into the course design, and creating the short videos were all elements contributing to bridge the generational gap between instructors and students.
Thank you so much for watching.